couple of quick announcements for you and some suggestions as far as the end of the week goes. As you know, we have Christmas Eve on a Friday. I have no idea how many people to expect for Christmas Eve services, because a lot of people may be out of town, because they may be going to see family and all those kinds of things. But what I do want to suggest is that I know that some people do not want to be around large groups of individuals at this time. That's fine, I understand where you are. If that is the case, then I would recommend that you might want to consider coming to the 11 o'clock service that evening or the 10 o'clock service on Christmas Day, because I would expect that the 5:30 service will have the largest number of individuals. So if you are concerned about being around a large number of people, consider coming to the 11 o'clock service or coming to the 10 o'clock service on Christmas Day. Just a suggestion. And as one minister told me, if this is my suggestions are free, and the only suggestions that are any good are the ones that you pay for. So if you don't like it, just round file it. All right. So anyhow, those are just a suggestion. I do. So we have services at 5:30 on Christmas Eve. That's Friday night. 11 o'clock Friday night. 10 o'clock on Saturday morning. And we have services on Sunday at 8 and 10:30. In the back on the table, there are there's a sign-up sheet for lessons and carols. Anybody is invited to come and be a reader on that day. We'll have one service that day at 10:30. There's a copy of a lesson back there. If you take a lesson, please write down on the sheet that you're going to, that you've taken that lesson and you plan to be here to read, so we know who to look out for, who to watch for on that Sunday. In addition, not only are the lessons back there, but they're numbered, so you can pick out which one you'd like to read. Okay, and anybody can be a reader. You don't have to be a lay reader in the church. Anyone is invited to read. All right. Also, I want to ask your prayers for Camp St. Christopher. I know that many of you may or may not have heard. Camp St. Christopher is our diocesan camp and conference center. It seems that the day before, one of the maintenance workers came to the camp. Normally goes to another part of the camp, but that morning parked in a different spot, decided to go use the restroom and saw smoke coming out of the small dining room area. What happened is that something shorted out in the tiles above the small dining room. The small dining room is the tables and chairs we think are going to be okay, but the rest of it is going to have to be completely redone. There's smoke and water damage in the kitchen and in the large dining room. Thankfully, those two rooms were not damaged by any fire at all. The fire was contained into that one small dining room. And the other thankful part is that there was St. Christopher closed down all of its activities at the beginning of last week, so nobody was there. Nobody got hurt. Another thing for the director, Bob Lawrence, to handle, Reverend Bob Lawrence. So they're going to have to take care of all of those different activities and things. But just keep the camp and all the people, the personnel in your prayers, because I know they're going to be looking at what they need to do to get started in the new year. I would imagine, considering what all is going on, that it's going to be delayed to bring more people back into the camp. Are there any other announcements for the good of the community?
Thank you.
Let us say together,
Savior of the nations come, Virgin Son, make you your home. Marvel now, O heaven and earth, and the Lord chose such birth.
Marvel, mystery, awe, and wonder. These are the words that seem rarely to find a place in our normal conversation, and some might add in our own experience. Christmas seems to be one of those times that has the capacity to quicken exalted wonder in every heart. May it be so for each of us this year. Lord, give us grace to awaken us, to see the branch begin to bloom. In great humility is in all heaven, in a little room. Let us pray. O, thank you, God, in the midst of all that fades and dies and disappears, there is one notable exception. You, who are before time and forever alone, has the ability to light in our hearts the flame that will not flicker or burn out. Ignite that fire now, and let it grow brighter each day until we return to celebrate your birth and the light of wonder grows bright again. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let us remain standing and sing our opening hymn.
Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration.
Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son, Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Micah, chapter 5, beginning with the second verse. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. Therefore Israel will be abandoned until the time when she is in labor bears, when she who is in labor bears a son, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth. And he will be our peace when the Assyrians invade our land and march through our fortresses. We will raise against them 7 shepherds, even 8 commanders. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm selected this morning is Psalm 80, verses 1 through 7. It is found on page 702 of the Book of Common Prayer and in your bulletin. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock.
Shine forth, we are on the chair.
In the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh,
stir up your strength.
Restore us, O God of good hosts.
Shed the light on your countenance, and we shall be saved.
O Lord, God of hosts,
how long will you be angry with thy prayers for the people?
You have fed them with the bread of tears.
You have given them bowls of tears to drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbors,
and our enemies laugh us to scorn.
Restore us, O God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
A reading from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, beginning with the first verse. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased." Then I said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, my God." First he said, "Sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, nor were you pleased with them, though they were offered in accordance with the law." Then he said, "Here I am, I have come to do your will." He sets aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once and for all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. The last 2 years of our life on this earth have brought about many changes. We have heard or seen of many detrimental aspects in people's lives as a result of the COVID virus. Many people became ill, many people succumbed to the disease. Loved ones were not able to be present during the illnesses or present even at the loss of their loved ones. Doctors and nurses became the new family in addition to trying to care for the many patients. During the period of isolation that we all endured, we witnessed people making multiple changes in their lives. Some individuals decided to change their jobs entirely. Companies began offering opportunities to work at home during and even after the isolation periods were lifted. And the time of isolation caused anxiety, stress, and even depression. Today we are still seeing the effects of the onset of COVID. Material shortages abound. In fact, we aren't even sure what the next shortage will be. Work projects are delayed because of a lack of workers and materials. Even the delivery of Christmas gifts has been affected. We were warned that if we wanted to be sure our gift packages would arrive before Christmas Day, we needed to have them in the mail by Sunday last week. I don't even remember the day. In short, there has been a great deal of anxiety and stress, and not a great deal of joy. And with a lack of joy, there is also a lack of praise to God. There's also a lack of faith in God's promises to us. And yet, through all we have endured, God has been present. We are reminded of God's continual presence in the gospel lesson this morning. Yes, we have seen many changes recently. And if we take a look at the entire story of Mary and her pregnancy, we are reminded that even in the changes and chances of this world, there is joy and praise because God is present, real, and active in our lives. And with that knowledge, we have much to celebrate. As we are all aware, at least I hope we are all aware, Mary is the mother of Jesus. What we might not remember is how young she was. See, in most of the artwork, sculptures, and stained glass windows, Mary appears to be in her late teens, even her early 20s. In actuality, We believe she was between the ages of 14 and 16, just a young girl. Then she is awakened in the night by the presence of an angel, Gabriel. And just the angel's presence would be enough to frighten someone, anyone. But now the angel tells this young girl she is going to have a child and she is to name him Jesus. And Mary asks, how? Of course she does. She is betrothed to Joseph. They have not had relations. And she does know how babies come into the world. The angel explains to her that the Holy Spirit will come upon her and that the child she carries will also be called the Son of God. To be sure, she understands. Gabriel explains to her that her cousin Elizabeth, who has been barren, is now with child. And he tells her directly, for nothing is impossible with God. Now for a moment, let's place ourselves in Mary's shoes. She is a young girl. She is betrothed to Joseph. The angel has just told her she is going to have a child, and Joseph is not to be the father. The child she will bear is also to be called Jesus, and he is the Son of God. And she knows that means he is the Messiah. How do we believe, or how do we think we would respond? What is amazing is this young girl's response. And her reply to the angel is, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. In those words, she accepts that the Lord God has chosen her. She accepts the task that God has chosen for her. And she accepts that the Lord God will take care of her. But then, she goes to see her cousin Elizabeth. Now, one reason for this journey is to see if what the angel has told her did indeed come to pass. She wanted to see for herself that Elizabeth was indeed with child. And as we heard in the reading, it was a very joyful event. Upon hearing Mary's greeting to her cousin, the baby inside Elizabeth leaped for joy. Now we know this child is John the Baptist, and Elizabeth begins to prophesy. She calls Mary and the child that Mary carries blessed. She also praises Mary for believing in what God has done and for what God will accomplish. It is the first expression of incredible joy and praise concerning the future birth of Jesus. In response, we hear Mary's reply. And Mary's reply is one of praise, joyful expectation, and prophecy of Jesus' works to come. We see her praise as she proclaims that her soul glorifies the Lord from the very depth of her heart and her being. She praises God. Now, when we recognize the works of the Lord around us, and in us, the first response is always to give praise. And in fact, we will see this type of praise repeated over and over again as Jesus heals the sick, casts out demons, and preaches good news to the poor. But we also see Mary's joy as she claims that her spirit rejoices. She has seen for herself what the angel has proclaimed concerning Elizabeth. She knows that God made this happen for her. She who was barren in her old age will have a child, a son of her own. And Mary is beside herself with joy, not only for Elizabeth, but for what God has accomplished. And at the same time, Mary is also aware that God will take care of her. God will lead her, and God will guide her. He will keep her, and he will protect her. Indeed, she will receive blessings and honor for accepting the task that God has asked her to do for generations to come. She is truly blessed. And finally, she shares that the baby growing inside what the baby growing inside her will accomplish. Through the will of God the Father, Jesus will bring down the high and lofty, He will lift up the poor, the needy, those in trouble, and those in prison. He will bring to all those who have been lost and put down in the world hope. God's salvation for the world will come through this baby yet unborn. And for all that Jesus will do, Mary gives thanks and praise to God, the God that Mary claims to be her Savior. In their joy, Elizabeth and Mary first give praise to God, who is indeed the Savior of the world. Now, as I said earlier, the last 2 years have been difficult. Like many, myself included, there has been a great deal of grumbling and complaining concerning a wide array of aspects of our life now. We have complained about the use of masks. We have complained about having to stay at home. We have complained about restrictions on travel. We have complained and complained, and the list is endless. However, at the same time, we have seen God, our Savior, at work in the world around us. Never in our history have vaccines been developed and made available so quickly. We have seen pharmaceutical companies and governments working together to find answers to very serious questions. Normally, pharmaceutical companies are competing against each other, aren't they? Everybody's trying to make a buck and make sure that they get what they repaid for all of the research and stuff that they've done. And we all know that governments love to talk to one another, don't they? But they did now. God's hand was moving. Individuals and small groups of people have taken the time to make masks and to prepare food for all types of hospital employees. Churches have found new ways to check on their people that they never imagined were possible. God has acted in the hearts of men and women everywhere to bring compassion, caring, and love to a world that is struggling with what many call the new normal. But it is time. It is time now for us to recognize that God is still our Savior. It is time for us to rejoice in what He has accomplished for us through Jesus Christ. And it is time for us to offer unceasing praise to the one who made us, redeems us, walks with us, lives within us, and offers eternal hope and salvation. Today, we have an incredible opportunity. Like Mary and Elizabeth, we have an opportunity to say, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Amen. Please turn to page 5 in your bulletin. Let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, but loved me from the Father. Through him all things were made. On the third.
Prayer to the People are found on page 387 of the Book of Common Prayer and in your bulletin. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That you may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word's guidance.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from racial threats.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
That light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We pray for those on our parish prayer list, on the Daughters of the King prayer list, and for those who are foremost on our hearts and minds this day. For Jeannie, for Ann, Dottie, Joan, and Jerry. For Bob, Lynn, Penny, Michael, David, John, Bono, Arden, for John L. We pray for safe travel for those who are on the highways and traveling to various locations also by air. We ask for their safety and protection. We pray, Lord, for your presence with all first responders, doctors, nurses, hospital staff. We also pray that you will be with all school employees and students while they are on this break. We also lift up all those who are celebrating birthdays in the coming week, Christy McLean and Gypsy Downey. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to be with them and to hold them in the hollow of your hand, where they may grow in their knowledge and love of you, and be present with you in each day of their life. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church. And give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and others.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, out of what we have done, out of what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. I do have one other announcement. We had a little change in the music, as you noticed. The choir sang the gradual, and my design is going to be singing the offertory. There was a reason for it. It's a very good and joyful reason. Jaron and Christy are taking Poppy. They've got to go and be at her birth country's embassy tomorrow in Washington. It is the last step of her adoption process. And so this is going, they have to go. Jaron asked if he could leave, if we could switch it so that he could leave earlier so they could get to Washington at a decent hour, hopefully before dark. And I said, absolutely, we'll work it out. So please pray for them, specifically for safe travel. What is very interesting in this is that this embassy does allow dual citizenship. But they have to hear it from Poppy. So they're asking a four-year-old child if she wants dual citizenship in her country and in the United States. They won't take it from Jaron and Christy. It has to be from her. So I find that very interesting, but that's the way I told you before, as I've said in the sermon, governments don't talk well to one another. Here's a living example, all right? So, but just pray for them, please. We're very happy that this is gonna hopefully be the last step in this process. Please keep them in your prayers. In addition, I want to make the announcement that I want everyone to know that if you are baptized and you receive communion in your own church, your own denomination, and you're here visiting today, you are welcome to receive communion here. We will distribute the wafer from right here, and then please pick up one of the communion cups and take it back to your seat to receive communion. We'll start with the musicians, then this side of the church, and then this side to follow. All right? If you have any questions, please just ask. We believe in holy whispering, and I'll have the microphone off. If you don't want to receive communion but would like to receive an individual blessing, when you come up for communion, place your hands like so in the shape of a cross. If you're coming up for a blessing, cross your hands like so across your shoulders. I believe the appropriate offertory sentence today comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, beginning at the first verse. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Oh, I so praise you, Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs of him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and bring triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
marks my faith with thanksgiving. Would you please join me in the prayer of spiritual communion for those at home? Dear Jesus, I believe you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you in my soul. And since I cannot receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, gathered under the altar of your church. And I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Thank you.
Those communion prayers found on the bottom of page 9 in the bulletin, or page 365 in the book of common prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have nourished the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now to the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and sinfulness of heart. Through our God's say amen after each petition of the Advent blessing. May Almighty God, by whose providence our Savior Christ came among us in great humility, sanctify you with the light of his blessing and set you free from all sin. Amen. Amen. May he whose second coming in power and great glory we await make you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love. Amen. Amen. May you who rejoice in the first advent of our Redeemer, at his second advent, be rewarded with unending life. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
teach to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.